Now I'm out of tune.
Just about. Now.
I was in tune. Okay, well, hello everybody, welcome to Tom's Guitar Show. I'm Tom, they call me Guitar Tom because I'm often seen with a guitar, and they call me on the phone, they ask me, they say, hey man, what's your show about anyway? I say, well, it's about an hour. It's about guitar players, guitar playing, all things guitaristic. So if you want to call me up, occasionally there'll be a number on your screen. Nobody ever calls anybody anymore, so, but if anybody wants to call, they can. Ask a question about, playing the guitar, the care and feeding of your guitar. What kind of guitar is right for you? If you want to talk about a related topic, like the guitarrón, or the sitar, or the guitarra, the uzuelas, banjos, balalaikas, bazookis, bajos, sextos, tiples, tres, chicholes, cavaquinhos, mandolins, mandoras, mandocellos, mandolas. You want to talk about, if I mention ukuleles, or banjolalis, banjolins, bandurias. We're talking about frets here, man. We're talking about frets. How about
B flat A and C clarinets?
Step up the microphone. I said B flat A and C clarinets. Clavinets. Clavinovas. Clavichords. Clavecin.
In that case, I guess I'll say xylophones and zithers.
Okay, anything. Pipe organs, piccolos, I don't care. Jaw harps, harpsichords, harmoniums, harmonicas. Pixie harps, Celtic harps, concert harps, mouth harps, I don't know, pan pipes, piccolos, I don't know if I said piccolos already, I don't care, tubas, trombones or trombomarinas, crumb horns, courtholes, cornetos, anything you can make music on is fine. We could talk about politics, world events, or your own personality problems, but it's fine, we're here for you, but keep it clean, this is a family program. Okay. I still think it's really funny when this guy called up and asked for dating advice from me and Phil. So,
well, I think it's the night we were getting calls from people that wanted to buy a boat.
That's right. Somebody put our number in the classifieds for had a boat for sale. The guy was so mad. Said, you shouldn't put this in there if you're not going to sell a boat. So, I didn't put it in there, but he wouldn't believe it. I don't know.
I notice your hat isn't black tonight.
Well, this is a new, I got this, I got two hats. I bought this one and a big white Panama earlier in the week. I should have done it, but I have to play all these outdoor gigs, through the summer, and I wanted something else, And A black hat is kind of hot in the summer, you know. And I have these ones that are ventilated.
The Amishmen all changed to straw in the summer.
Yeah, well, I don't blame them, you know. So I'm kind of doing a straw thing here. I did have the big white Panama. I think it was kind of fun. I had a white slacks, a white V-neck T-shirt, you know, basically undershirt, and a white Panama hat with a black strap, and my white sneakers. And I thought I looked like the Ice Cream Man or Colonel Saunders. You know, I should be sitting on the back porch drinking a mint julep or something.
Or selling ice cream.
Or selling ice cream, yeah. But that was vetoed at home, so I've changed. I'm looking like this now. The hat was almost vetoed, but I persevered, and I'm wearing this hat instead of a black hat. And if you know French, I can't say this. Tell this joke on the. On the TV because it's a family show. But if anybody knows French and wants to have there's an American who wants to buy a chapeau noir, parce que ma belle-mère est morte. But it's a joke, but I can't tell it because it's not family friendly, and it's half in French.
I notice our youth movement continues.
Well, we have a new. Yeah, we have a new person.
Let's get her to come over here and introduce herself.
Yeah, go ahead and be on TV. Yeah. We got our new, I guess, a volunteer. Not an intern, but an actual volunteer. There's no business like show, business like no business I know. Everything about it is exciting. Yeah, step up to the mic. Yeah, go right ahead. You're not on camera yet. He's gonna.
Hi.
BJ has to switch us over. So is there anybody in the chair back there? Oh yeah, he's there. Okay. He's got. Okay, there you are. All right. So you're the new. You're a volunteer, right? That's
your. Yeah, just learning different skills in video editing and production.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Hi guys.
Okay. Well, tell us your name. At least your first name.
I'm Danielle.
Danielle. Okay. And,
yeah.
And you said you recently graduated from the U of I.
Yes, I'm a recent graduate of University of Iowa.
Uh-huh.
Hawkeye for life.
Okay, well, there you go.
Yes.
Are you like a film major or something?
So I graduated in politics. I did some organizing, and I just was really fascinated with communications. I love storytelling, and I love putting together images and stories and putting them out for people to just absorb and react to, mm-hmm. I guess.
Yeah, well.
We were just talking earlier. You had tons of stories, and I just think it's great. You can.
I've got a lot of stories.
He does. You can put it. You can express it in music or in a video, in a movie, however you want to. And I just love that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, we are a bit of a community media center, and likely to become even more so as time changes. You know, because we're. Things are changing. It's more than just cable TV now, in fact.
Yeah.
Do you watch cable TV at all?
No, I watch more like documentaries, public television. And then also, because of the way cable is, I guess more people watch these independent television, these independent series that are on... YouTube or
Vimeo.
Yeah, these video media series, which are really independent and interesting, and mm-hmm. then I guess Hulu and Netflix has tons of independent mm-hmm. things that are just independent of the cable industry.
Oh yeah.
Which is better for independent creators, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, certainly, and. You know, this is obviously, this show goes out over the local cable, and I think that nobody watches it, but I keep running into people who do watch it, and usually older people, but
now that we have someone young in front of the camera.
I'm young. Everyone working here is young at heart, or...
Well, they're actually young by my standard, but
this has
become a show for old men, but I'll have you know that I've been doing this show for 21 years now, so
you
can tell that I'm getting to be an old geezer, We're on cable, but we're also on YouTube, and there's a live stream.
Yeah.
So a lot of people watch like that. I think a lot of people. So I don't actually, you know, we don't have a TV, but it's not actually hooked up to anything. It's just gathering dust, and I wanted to have the screen, you know, so I could you know, put an antenna on it or hook it up to a, you know, a Blu-ray or a DVD player or something like that. Or, and I watched one, I got the TV really cheap. I hooked up to my little notebook computer, and I watched actually a show from the early 90s. I think it was Northern Exposure. I watched a rerun of that from YouTube on the TV just to see it worked. And it was fine. But then I now it's sitting on a cart up at the end of the, you know, in the bedroom, for not hooked up to anything, just getting dusty.
Yeah.
But, you know, on the computer, because I had this big, fairly big screen, I had this iMac that I've had for like 8 years now, but it's got a big screen on it. And so I watched, you know, mostly YouTube, but Vimeo and Hulu, and I don't seem to get around to Netflix because the whole movie takes a while. So
it does.
But you know, I watch these shorter things by these independent producers, and I think that's the way a lot of people are going. Except a lot of people don't even do that; they watch stuff on their phone. So so what I need to do is
that's true.
Distill this to like a 40-second show instead of a 1 hour.
Young people, those of us in the bifocal generation.
Yeah. I like that too, though, because sometimes it gets into citizen journalism,
right,
where they just report in like just art of reporting what's around you, sort of, and like recording your own music, sort of just easy, taking pictures of what's around you so everyone can be a photographer, or everyone can be you know, everyone can record a documentary of what's
or be a reporter and report the little news stories.
Or report, what's really going on, when maybe it's not, the truth is not out there, but everyone's truth is out there now.
Right. So. Well, everybody's got a camera on their phone.
Yeah.
But the thing, we've been doing citizen journalism now for a long time, since, you know, you have to carry a big camcorder on your shoulder, you know. Mm-hmm. It was like this big. I had a VHS camcorder that was about that big, and I don't think you can see that at home because I'm obviously I'm on your TV screen. But you know, I had to put it on my shoulder, which actually kind of helps because it helps to stabilize it. So you know, that was a long time ago. And then when we had the 3/4-inch U-matic, which is a big, heavy, huge cassette, you know, tape. And now we don't do tape anymore. We haven't done tape for a long time. So there was sort of the age of the palm quarter. Now there's the phone. And so, I mean, things have changed, but I think we're still relevant. Tell me we're still relevant.
We're still relevant.
He said we're still relevant. What do you think?
What do you mean, you or?
I mean, as a TV station, we're still relevant.
I think one of the things I like about this station is that it teaches essential skills to the community, and that's never going to go out of style, is that these skills are so necessary for people to learn, like me and everyone here, skills training, and then it's just affordable. And then another thing is this independent creators. You're still an independent creator, and just putting that out without the all the red tape,
right?
You know, and this is what the community is like right here, just everyday people being able to put out their art or their talents, and I think I guess there's just not there's not as much exposure to, people just don't know about PTA, they just don't know about the station as much as they should.
How
did you hear about PATV? I know, I knew someone who had a show here, and Ava Sue, had a dance show here. And then I also had a friend who did a program here as well. And so I've heard a few community members who just through them I knew of it. So I just knew I wanted to check it out myself and just see how I could grow or learn, and how it could be helpful to me as a recent grad who wants to transition into something else. And I think it's relevant to everybody because there's something that everyone can get out of it, you know? Like, even if you just want to rent the equipment, or if you just want to learn how to use cameras or something different, or if you want to, like, try your hand at storytelling or get your music out there, you know, there's a little bit of something for everybody.
I think one thing is you can come here and you have...
Do some PSAs.
They can't hear you over there, but... one thing is that you get into a community, so you can actually, by working on a crew or whatever, you get to meet other people.
Yeah.
And if you work on their shows, perhaps if you need to assemble a crew, you'll be in, you know, you have new contacts in some people. So if you need people to work cameras and so forth. So On this show, we've processed quite a few interns and volunteers over the years. We've gazillions of them. Well,
dozens anyway.
Yeah, maybe a couple hundred. I don't know. I mean, you know, yeah, more than 100 for sure.
I think it's just people just don't know about it existing.
Yeah.
A lot as well, much as people just don't know as much about how much you can get out of it. They don't know about it, but it's here, and I know a few people who have benefited from it. So I wish I would have known earlier, but because it's so much more expensive to take these type of classes through the university. Hmm. And get this type of education, but it's just like hands-on education.
Yeah. Well, the nice thing here is if you don't really have to pay, you can work it off.
Yeah, and you can just learn trying.
Yeah, you can take all the workshops, and then you can pay the workshop fees by actually working on other people's shows, and they could use the help. And also you get a lot more experience, which I always figured because this show is very easy, I think, to make and very boring because it's just me standing here and playing guitar and talking to Bob and whoever else may come in. But you get a lot more experience of doing it, you know, actually working with the equipment. And then we put you in there and you direct the show and everything eventually. You go through the same, BJ's in there doing the switching now. He's our director tonight. For the first time, but he's getting, you know, he's doing a good job. He does a good job and he's, you know, gotten a lot of experience because he's becoming a veteran, you see. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's something about this. My head's disappearing. It's melting into the blue behind me. Ah. Wow, man. It's getting like surreal. Anyway. Well.
Our virtual studio's eating you.
The surrealness.
Yeah.
The surreal guitarists.
That's right. I'll have you know I have this green sparkly guitar that I just has been gathering dust hanging on the wall for years. And I got it down. I've got it all shined up and cleaned up. And took all the strings off, and I'm going to restring it. So, like, you know, it would take me 20 minutes of work, and I'll have another guitar. But this one's green, so we use a green screen. So I have my sparkly green guitar, and I can, it'll, like, what we can do is use a black curtain behind me, and then put anything we want. We've done that before. I had a green guitar before. We had a Three Stooges Pie Fight on my guitar throughout the show. But anyway. But, okay, well. Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Hope you come back next couple weeks, and we'll
see how things go. Thank you so much.
We'll take advantage of your skills. And B flat sure is a foul chord. Thank you. Telling Bob how I wasn't sure if I liked this guitar, but I bonded with it. So
is it true that Scotty is going to beam Tom and the Tribbles down to Riverside for their annual appearance?
Well, actually, we are now, Tom and the Tribbles is the house band of Trekfest. So we'll be there on the Saturday of Trekfest, which
That's
is
the last weekend in June.
The last Saturday of June from 11 to 1, around the lunch hour. There, lunch hours. And they'll be our band. And I'll tell you, we're in this wild kind of rehearsal kind of phase where, because we keep adding new material and we have, you know, the personnel changes over time. So we have new people. We have a tenor banjoist. We also have a rock singing 12-string guitar player, but he won't be there, unfortunately. So we shouldn't have, we've got these sort of 60s classic rock stuff we're incorporating. So, but yeah, we'll be there. And
where else can people see you?
Well, you can watch me play guitar and have a nice dinner at the Tuscan Moon on Friday night. Now, Saturday, I will be playing hooky. I have two gigs on Saturday. I have a wedding and the vascular surgeon graduation party. And both are events that will be in hotel ballrooms and one's at the Vetro, and one I think is at the Marriott. But I'll be playing both of these one after the other. And I'm going to try to hightail it from one to the next. So, I got to practice for that wedding because the guy wants some classical guitar music. And he plays classical guitar, so I better not screw it up. Huh? I'm supposed to be good, you know. Yeah. I was supposed to be a good guitar player. And sometimes, you know, we all fall short, you know. But Friday night I'll be at the Tuscan Moon in beautiful downtown Kelowna, Iowa, right by the bakery there. Can't miss it.
Exit 80 off of 218.
Yeah, I always take 218 down. You can take Highway 1. Anyway, you slice it. It's right there. It's at 5th Street or something. Right downtown. If you take the sign for Business District, it's right smack dab in the middle of that. It's not hard to find. But I'll be there. I'm supposed to start at 6, so I'm usually there by 6:30. And I'm supposed to get done at 9, but I'm usually play till 10 nowadays. And it's... I hope it doesn't rain, because outside it's great. I mean, this patio area, with the pergola and the plants growing and the little lights strung across, you know, and then you can, when the wind is blowing a certain way, you can smell the cinnamon rolls from the bakery next door, and when it's blowing another way, you get the horses. That's from the sale barn, so the smell of horses. Makes you think you're really out in the country.
You know, but you're really al fresco.
That's right. So if it rains, I'm indoors, which is nice, too. It's the old hotel. They used to have a hotel. It's like 1900-ish, red brick edifice. But yeah, I'll be there. And then next week, I think am I doing both next week, Friday and Saturday? I've got some gigs coming up. That's my summer weddings and
we'll banquets. Bring people up to date next Tuesday.
Yeah, but I'm there a lot. I'd suggest... getting reservations, so yeah. At the Tuscan Moon in Kelowna, I get reservations and well in advance, and then try to get a seat outside if it's going to be outdoors, because it's really nice out there. It's fine inside too, but it's the outdoors experience is something. During the later winter, this late winter, early spring, it's pretty dead there, and they have shorter hours for that. You know, it dies after New Year's, because the whole party thing is going pretty well.
Yeah.
And then New Year's, it just dies, and then there's a big uptick for Valentine's Day, which is, of course, when you really need the Spanish guitar, you see. Then it's like dead until some of it starts coming back to life in April, and then May starts really going, and now it's like you need to get reservations for sure. And you'll need to get reservations all the way through till Christmas or past Christmas. But anyway.
We could remind people that the last Tuesday of every month, we go on location.
Yeah.
And they can watch this magic being made at Uptown Bill's Coffee Shop.
Which is upstairs.
At the corner of South Dubuque and Lafayette.
Yeah, right above us. We are beneath them. Yeah, that's coming up too. This month is going kind of fast already.
Yep.
That's just, we're not in the double digits yet, are we? Almost, though. It's the ninth or something today?
Today's the ninth.
Yeah, okay, see. Yeah, there it goes.
Anyway, I interrupted you. You started to tell us about that guitar.
Well, this is a Sheraton 2, an Epiphone Sheraton 2. So this is made in Asia. But it's a copy of a guitar that they made in the 60s. And it's actually a pretty good guitar. I got it. I think I got it at the pawn shop, actually. Money and More. They gave me a free T-shirt there because everybody knows my name, you know. There's a Tom Waits song where the bartenders all know my name, but it's me. It's the music merchants, you know. I go into the guitar shops and here in Cedar Rapids. People, oh, hi, Tom. You know. But anyway, so I bought this one, and it was dirty, and it needed a friend. So I bought it on a whim. It wasn't super cheap. Like some of the ones I get there. Because sometimes you can get a really good deal here. This is a decent deal, but I forget what I paid for it, but it's a few hundred dollars, you know. I think these are usually like $600 new. And this is in new condition now, I think. I cleaned it all up and restrung it. But I didn't really bond with it because I couldn't get the sound I wanted. But I played this actually last Friday at the Tuscan Moon. And I realized I couldn't... You have to know how to play each guitar. You know how to... dial it up in the amplifier, and I'm using my Superchamp XD again, my Superchamp XD amp. It's a Fender. So it's a tube amp with digital effects on it. So it's all tubes, but it has digital effects. It's not it's sort of a hybrid between a solid state amp and a tube amp. So it makes a pretty good amp. It's fairly small. On Friday night, I actually used the Orange Crush, which is a small solid-state amp, which is bright orange. It says orange in the front of it, so you know it's an orange. And I got a really good sound. It was a good guitar. It was a good guitar sound, a good like jazz guitar sound. So I played it. And one thing I was thinking about as I was playing it, because I'm always a little bit afraid to. Take an electric guitar to a white tablecloth kind of, you know, gig. Fancy restaurant where you get a nice, people get a really high quality steak or seafood and fancy bottles of wine and stuff like that. And I always think I should take a classical guitar or at least a real jazz guitar. And this one's sort of This is basically the same design as a ES-335 Gibson, which is what B.B. King played for all those years. But anyway, but so I was there, and there was a 60th reunion, a class reunion, class of 1955. And I was looking at these people. Some of them were, like, really old, and some of them were in pretty good shape, and, you know, very spry and very engaged in life. But look at the people there I was playing for. And nobody minded my electric guitar. They were fine. I started thinking, you know, if you're a class of 55, that means you're probably born in 1937. So, you know, in 1955, Elvis was already launched in his career when they got out of high school. Bill Haley and the Comets was going, you know.
Buddy Holly.
Chuck Berry, Buddy Holly, if you can hear what he's saying. But Buddy Holly, yeah, you know, he died a few years later. And, you know, they weren't exactly old, you know, when the Beatles hit the scene, you know. They were, what, 1964, 1962? I mean, you know, they were, because so if they were 20 in 1957, then they were 25 in 1962. So here I am playing a guitar. I mean, there's a picture of John Lennon with the same guitar, except his is probably made in Kalamazoo, Michigan. This is probably made in China because times change. But the same exact guitar with all the same mother of pearl, the same color, everything. John Lennon holding one in about 1964 to 63, something like that. So, you know, when I was a young fellow, you could tell that I'm an old man. I'm telling the young woman who's over here, she's, you know, just starting out in life, just graduated. But you could tell I'm getting to be an old geezer, you know. But when I first started in this business, if you think about it, like, say 30 years ago, the people who were having a fancy dinner when I had my gig at the athletic club, who are the same age, for instance, as these people, they were born in 1907. So, you know, Glenn Miller, you know. Of course, when they were graduating from high school, people were listening to 5'2", Eyes Are Blue, oh, what those 5 feet could do, has anybody seen my gal?
Huh? We've heard you do that 40s stuff.
Yeah.
Cry Me a River.
Yeah. That's actually early 50s, but yeah, yeah. You must remember, this was 1931, but in Casablanca, you know, the...
Yeah, play it again,
as,
Sam.
Yeah, as
play,
time goes
play
by.
It again, Tom.
But you see, the thing was, that was 1942, and it was an old song then. Yeah. You see, it was from 1931, so they could reminisce about the good old days before the Nazis ruined everything for them, you see. I guess Humphrey Bogart, and, you know, his character in the movie had a little trouble with the Spanish Civil War and stuff, and I guess he couldn't go back because he was... probably fighting for the communists or something. I don't know, man. I'll have to go home and watch again. But it's a little out of tune. All right, sorry. I was going to play more guitar than talk about it, but. Close enough for torch songs. Thank you. played it for her, you can play it for me. Casablanca, you know that movie? You watch Casablanca? Humphrey Bogart? You should. It's an old one. It's really old. 1942. Oh, okay.
I like the music, it sounds beautiful.
But you didn't recognize it.
It's a...
But I wanted to.
Well, I suggest everybody should watch Casablanca. And, you know, I say, well, that's before my time. That's before my time, too. So, maybe not quite before your time.
Well, I think it's before, I was pretty young at the time.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, I was probably 2 or 3.
Yeah, okay, well. But, as well before I was born, but still.
But everything came back on television, and now with cable, everything comes back again.
And again, and again, and again. Yeah. And we would just always say, who watches cable TV? Which is a bad thing to say, because that's where we are. We're on cable TV.
And as Danielle mentioned earlier, if you want to learn how to produce a cable TV show, come on down here.
Yeah, or a TV show in general.
Corner of South Dubuque and Lafayette.
Yeah, we can... you can learn about it, and you can have all kinds of excitement and make new friends who can be on your future crew.
This is do-it-yourself television.
That's right. But we have, well, you don't have to do it yourself, though, because you have other people. You got the highly professional staff and people gaining experience. Our excellent director here and our new volunteer. And, of course, there's Bob, who's been among us for a few years now and quite a few years. And you're a big wig over at the Senior Citizen TV station.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's good. Well.
Yeah, well, we might mention that, too. If you're old people,
yeah.
I mean, you can still come here. They let me in here.
Yeah.
But over at the Iowa City Johnson County Senior Center, we have a TV studio there. And if you show up at 10:30 on Monday morning, room 205, we will be happy to start teaching you to run a TV camera up there. Or an edit bay.
Yeah.
Everything you'd ever want to know about making your own TV show.
Well, the people I run into who watch this show, you know, who really watch this show and you know, tune into it regularly, are all in the age group where they could actually go over there and produce things, I think. I think a lot of people will see this show because they flip back and forth because it's a commercial. They clip and say, oh, the guitar guy on TV. Good. And click. And they go back to watching that rerun of Seinfeld they've seen 37 times. But no soup for you.
Yeah, we need to have Danielle over here doing her PSA during when the commercials are on the broadcast stations.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah. Well, we should actually have a lot of... We were talking about having a PSA being one of the things you have to do when you do your workshops, you know? And some of them could be creative, and some of them, of course, you could see, like, interesting people you can identify with. I mean, some people might identify more with Danielle than they do with Bob over here, you know? I mean,
and
or vice versa. I don't know. But
some of mine on YouTube are unsuitable for a family program. But
yeah, right. Yes, well, we try to keep it clean on Tom's Guitar Show. I mean, I play the occasional. See, this is called a flat five. That was uncalled for. That's what they call a flat five, you know, because, well, you know, we talked about this in the show a couple of years ago, I guess. But the population of this town, like 20% of it, you know, changes, at least 20% changes every year. Because, like, you know, so many X thousand people leave and so many thousand people come in from different places. And a lot of them from China these days. But, and then they are, and after some years they leave, but more people come. So every year, you know, we keep refreshing and rotating so people... But anyway, the thing about the... I was talking about obscenities on TV, so I and as far as I'm going to go on this show is a flat five. But see, if you have... So if you have a... Or... Either way, it's minor scale. Or... That's a perfect fifth. Sounds perfect, doesn't it? Here's an octave. See, what's an octave? See, well, you know what an octopus is? So, yeah, well, it's not that. But octopus has 8 legs. Octave. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. You go up eight notes, you get the same note again, only they're an octave apart. But if you go up five, you get a perfect fifth.
Well, I put together this weekend the chorus, Voices of Experience chorus up at the Senior Center. Mm-hmm. In their concert, they did the Do Re Mi song. So mm-hmm. I had that stuck in my head all day.
I don't like that musical very much. I am 16 going on. I like it when the old nun goes, climb every mountain, ford every stream. What a waste of time. Climbing every mountain, fording every stream? No.
50 years old, isn't it?
Never mind. All right, where was I? I was talking about the fifth. Okay, so we have the octave, right? Kind of like an octopus, but quite different, really. If you only go up a fifth, you get the fifth. Yeah? Here's another one.
Well, just to wear my classical snob hat for a second, uh-huh. I don't think isn't it that we can't speak of the perfect intervals as sharp or flat? Isn't it like an augmented or a diminished fifth?
Oh, no. I'm talking like a jazz musician. It's a flat five, baby.
Flat five, yeah. Technically it is. It's like instead of C, G, play C and G flat.
If you, I'll kind of swing both ways, but I at my old age, I lean more toward the jazz
towards
thing
because
it's so much easier. Say it's 1/4
that's
five,
more of the point,
so dominant subdominant, or tonic subdominant dominant. See, it's 1/4 5, baby, mm-hmm. And I want to say baby. I say 1/4 5, baby, but I don't do that. You know, I'm not afraid of you. I'm just afraid that like where I teach up there in the college, they'll.
Yeah, that's where I was thinking you might get busted up.
I might get busted for saying it's 1/4 5, baby. So I'm just talking like somebody from New Orleans, I'm just talking like a jazz. And then you find yourself, once you start talking about jazz, you call everybody man. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, man, it's going to be a 7-year-old girl. It's a flat five, man. Anyway,
much more sensible to call something a half note than a demiquaver or whatever.
Semi-hemi-demi-semi-quaver, that'd be a 30-second note. Hemi-quaver, temi-quaver, demi-hemi-demi-semi. Mm-hmm. Yeah, semi-quaver is an eighth note, isn't it? And then hemi-demi-semi.
Yeah,
I call it 16th note, because I don't want to fool around, man.
Right, okay.
And you could talk the degrees of the scale. Mm-hmm. They give them, there's a tonic and a supertonic and the subdominant. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Mm-hmm. So I call it a flat five because I
sounds good.
I hang around with jazz musicians. I don't do drugs, mm-hmm. but I do hang around with jazz musicians, and I, I've been behaving more like a jazz guitar player today. You say it's
flat five. It is.
It's a flat five, and that's what it says. If you read charts like lead sheet in the jazz fake book, or the real book, it's going to say this is going to be like. This could be a B minor 7 flat 5, or it could also be a B half diminished, or 1/2 dim, or a B with a circle with a line through it. Depends on how cool you are. Minor 7 flat 5, it's kind of a lot to write out, but a circle with a line through it. Anyway, so what I'm saying is, okay, so you have this is a perfect fifth. Here's a flat 5. That's really nasty, isn't it? But the flat five can be kind of, slinky. Let me make a loop. I got my little looper here on the floor. Thank you. speaking of music, last night I didn't get to sleep at. Well, I did get to sleep, but I spent some time on YouTube again, like I often do. We were talking about that earlier, but I was interested in somebody Gold, Andrew Gold's dad, who's a composer, wrote a lot of movie music, and he did the music for the motion picture Exodus, which is, I guess, a 1960 production of basically about Israel, the formation of Israel, the modern Israel, the government, you know, and they had this, and I think I saw that movie once, but I don't remember much except the soundtrack of some very, you know, big music, you know. So I listened to the theme from Exodus, the movie, and then I watched a bunch of other listened to a bunch of other soundtrack things of Jerry Goldsmith and of course Elmer Bernstein, or Bernstein, I don't know, Elmer, and a bunch of the other this movie music, and some of the greatest music of the 20th century was actually the movie music. I mean the stuff that we. I mean, of course, there's Ravel and Debussy and stuff in the very earlier part of the century, but a lot of the stuff that you really, that really sounds good, because the academic music, the music got kind of atonal and kind of hard to deal with, and people didn't like Samuel Barber because he was too 19th century and stuff, so the academy really, a lot of people feel this way, you know, you really can't listen to the serious music, what you call the classical music of the 20th century, because it's all atonal. Once Stravinsky broke all the rules, and then they, you know, and everybody else took the ball and ran with it. And most people just can't listen to that stuff. But some of the movie music was really spectacular when you listen to it, especially like some of the big epic westerns, you know, those big budget westerns and things.
The Marlboro Man and the Magnificent Seven?
I listened to the Magnificent Seven. But the real thing was a suite of the Magnificent Seven done by some symphony orchestra more recently. They had the scores, you know. So they did the bum, 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 like a... That's not. I mean, I'm just finger picking a little folk guitar here.
Danielle, are you too young to remember cigarette commercials?
No. You didn't see any cigarette commercials in your lifetime.
I guess I was more of the era for don't do drugs.
Yeah, yeah.
Or say no to drugs.
Say no. Just say no.
Oh, the song he was just playing, Marlboro Cigarettes, used to play that 20 times an hour on almost every TV station.
Yeah, that was the.
I was more of the anti-cigarette.
Yeah. A little younger
No, that was the 1960s. I think they banned cigarette advertisements in the 70s, something.
I think so.
So that was before your time. I'm assuming you were born in the 90s. 88, okay. Well, all right.
Close enough.
Yeah, okay.
So cigarette commercials were long gone by the time you were watching TV.
Cigarette, yeah, she was. But there was a Marlboro man who was this guy who would be looking heroic up on the ridge on his horse, and he'd light up a Marlboro cigarette, which used to be a women's cigarette. And then they weren't selling them very well, so they marketed them to the rugged outdoors fellow, because it's the same cigarette, but there used to be a lady's cigarette, you see, back in the day. Yeah. But I was reading about that too. But the Marlboro man, the actor himself.
Well, a couple of them.
Yeah, but the main Marlboro man died of emphysema, mm-hmm. and he did anti-smoking, you know, commercials or whatever, or ads, whatever, and he was gay, which I think was kind of nice. He was. Like the actor himself was gay, and he died of lung disease. But he sure looked good up there in his cowboy suit, riding a horse up on the ridge with his cigarette. Anyway, never mind. Don't smoke. It's not good for you. The Marlboro. They had the Marlboro commercial. They used the theme for the Magnificent Seven, which was actually a wonderful piece of music. If you listen to the whole thing. You know, the whole, with all the flutes and the bells and the whistles and everything, amazing piece of music. And a lot of that 20th century, like, soundtrack stuff, which you don't have to watch the movies, you can just watch, you know, listen to the soundtracks. Go on YouTube. And they used to, you know, publish the soundtrack records, and now you can just listen to them. And they also have Sergio Leone
Spaghetti Westerns.
Spaghetti Westerns. Those, that music was very interesting. Yeah. I was listening to some of those old, no, early Clint Eastwood movies, Fistful of Dollars and stuff like that. And but the very, very interesting use of different instruments and so forth that he had.
We should probably get Mr. Skopinski out here to tell us about the wonders of John Williams movie scores.
Yeah, he derivative. What's the difference between being derivative and plagiarism? I don't know. We're almost out of time anyway. I should probably play something. Like... I kind of like this guitar, really. Was it Impulse? I saw this, and this guitar, and thought, I just have to have it. I've got a problem. I mean, Bob knows this. You're new here, but
gas is
guitar acquisition syndrome, because you can't stop acquiring guitars. You just, you get itchy, and you know what people are like into alcohol or. Compulsive gamblers, people like that. We all know about, meth and everything like that. And cigarettes, too. I mean, you don't, if you're a nicotine freak, you don't have to, wonder, you know, when you're going to want to have your next cigarette. You just, your body's going to tell you, time to get another one. So my main problem is guitars. I've even pretty much given up sugar, you know. I just got nothing left except guitar acquisition syndrome. And sometimes it gets kind of bad. A couple weeks ago, last week, I think I got two guitars. And, and they're both interesting and fun to have. Didn't need either one of them. I have better examples. Under a minute? Oh, I better go. Okay, here we go. Anyway, bye, everybody. I'll be back next week. I always come back.